may sound like I'm just sounding like a fire and brimstone imam of old or something like that. You don't have to ask me. You can ask the most prominent atheists of our time that believe that life has no purpose and everything is a coincidence and nothing has any meaning. You can ask them. The only thing that will anchor life in meaning is that message there. Ilahukum ilahun wahid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us realize that. So Rasul's plea to us is, فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ? Won't you? Or so are you submitted to me? It's framed in the positive sense, but the understanding that one gets from it, فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ? It's like a plea. The best way to translate it in English is, won't you then submit? Now you might ask me, there's no negative in there. I'm telling you, in terms of rhetoric, there's no negative in there, but the best way to translate it, to convey that meaning, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this construction elsewhere as well. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the alcohol, فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ? The best way to translate it, won't you stop now? فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا. Then Allah says, فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا. So if تَوَلَّوْا, they turn away. فَقُلْ. They say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, آذَنْتُكُمْ عَلَى سَوَى. آذَنْتُكُمْ means what? To announce. إذان, to announce. So I, or it can also mean to warn. To warn. آذَنْتُ, which bab is that? Fourth bab. Right? The soul, or the root of this word is udhun, ears. So that has something to do with hearing. Adhana means to cause people to hear. So I have warned you, I have made known to you, I have informed you. Ala sawa'in. What does that mean now? Ala, upon sawa. Sawa literally means equal. Sawa literally means equal. For things to be in conformity with each other, equal. So what does this mean? This means, أَذَنْتُكُمْ عَلَى سَوَى. It means like, in all fairness, I have warned you. In all fairness, all things level. Whether you turn away, whether you accept the message, all things equal, whatever the situation may be, I have informed you. And this meaning is as well, was asked by Rasulullah in a different form, in his Hajjatul Wada'. What did he say? أَلَا هَلْ بَلَّغْتُ. Rasul asked the question, have I conveyed the message to you? And then the response was what? بَلَّغْتَ الرِّسَالَ وَأَدَّيْتَ الْأَمَانَ وَكَشَفْتَ الْغُمَّ وَنَصَحْتَ بِالْهُمَّ. So Rasul asked the question, هَلْ بَلَّغْتَ, have I conveyed? This is asking the same, this is the same statement Rasul is making. فَقَدْ آذَنْتُكُمْ عَلَى سَوَى. All fairness, I have conveyed the message to you. وَإِنْ أَدْرِي. What does that in mean? That in is in nafiyah. That in is in nafiyah. Wa in adri, I do not know. Wa in adri, and I do not know. Aqaribun. A means whether. That adi means whether. وَإِنْ أَدَرِي أَقَرِيبٌ. I do not know whether it is قَرِيب, whether it is near, أَمْ بَعِيدٌ, or it is far. قَرِيبٌ is نَكِرَة, بَعِيدٌ is نَكِرَة as well. What's the فعل of the sentence? What is near, what is far? مَا تُوَعَدُونَ. So the question is actually, I do not know whether مَا تُوَعَدُونَ قَرِيبٌ أَمْ بَعِيدٌ. I do not know that, what is تُوَعَدُونَ? Wa'ada means to promise. Wa'ida, to be promised. So tu'aduna, what you have been promised. It's actually present tense. That which you are promised. I do not know whether that which you are promised is near or far. Innahu ya'lamu al-jahra min al-qawli wa ya'lamu ma taktumun. Innahu, indeed he, who? Allah ya'lamu, he knows al-jahra min al-qawl. What's jahr? Jahra means to proclaim or to make something open, right? So innahu ya'lamu, he knows al-jahra, the public min al-qawl, of speech, or that speech which is proclaimed openly. وَيَعْلَمُ and يَعْلَمُ and he knows مَا تَكْتُمُونَ that which you كَتَمَ يَكْتُمُ means to conceal. Now, you may think that these two sentences look like they're juxtaposing something, but they're not speaking about the same thing. What is مَا تُوَعَدُونَ? مَا تُوَعَدُونَ is the punishment, the day of Qiyamah, that's what it's referring to. Rasulullah says, I don't know whether what you have been promised of reward and of punishment and of the final hour, etc., I do not know whether that is near or close. But Allah knows what you proclaim openly and Allah knows what you conceal. They're not speaking about the same thing. The one is speaking about your speech, the other one is speaking about the final hour. One is speaking as affirming or is negating knowledge, and the other one is affirming knowledge. So there is some kind of comparison there. But what is the message that Rasulullah is giving us? The day of consequence for you is something unknown to you. But be certain that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, for the thing that Allah will take you to account for, all of it is known to Allah. You do not know when the day of reckoning is, when the day of account will come. But know that everything that you will be accounted for, you will be taken to account for, is known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The time of account is not known, but what will be accounted for is all well known and accounted for. So what's the message in that? Listen, make sure every moment you are doing things that are suitable to present on that day. You don't know when it's going to come. And that is, there's a similar verse like that in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّوَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اِتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Oh, you who believe, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it is right that you have taqwa to Him, of Him. But what else does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. And don't die except whilst you are a believer. Now, we have no control over when we die, right? Unless we're committing suicide. May Allah save us on that. But what's the message in the verse? The message in the verse is, be a Muslim at every single moment, because you don't know when death is going to come to you. The only variable that you have control over is your Islam, not your death. So it's the same meaning that's being conveyed in these two verses here. وَإِنْ أَدْرِيَ قَرِيبٌ مَا تُوَعَدُونَ وَإِنْ أَدْرِيَ قَرِيبٌ أَمْ بَعِيدٌ مَا تُوَعَدُونَ إِنَّهُ يَعْلَمُ الْجَهْرَ مِنَ الْقَوْلِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تَكْتُمُونَ وَإِنْ أَدْرِي لَعَلَّهُ فِتْنَةٌ لَكُمْ أَوْ مَتَاعٌ إِلَى حِينٍ. وَإِنْ أَدْرِي again, and I do not know. لَعَلَّهُ لَعَلَّ means what? Perhaps. لَعَلَّهُ فِتْنَةٌ, perhaps it is a fitna, a trial. لَكُمْ, perhaps it is a trial and a test for you. وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَىٰ حِينٍ, and an enjoyment or provisions for a period of time. So what is the لَعَلَّهُ referring to? لَعَلَّهُ فِتْنَةٌ. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you respite. The time that you have until that punishment comes, or recompense comes, or reckoning comes, that time may be a trial for you, or it may be provisions for a period of time. And Mufassirin also say, the other thing that it could be referring to, مَا تُوَعَدُونَ. لَعَلَّهُ, what's the who referring to? The who is referring to مَا تُوَعَدُونَ. Perhaps what you have been promised is either a trial for you, or it is provisions for a period. قَالَ رَبِّ, the last verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ, he said, رَبِّحْكُمْ بِالْحَقِّ, Rabbi. What does that mean? Oh my Lord. Who's saying? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, Rabbi, oh my Lord, uhkum bil haq. Uhkum? Judge. Pass judgment. Uhkum bil haqi. What does that mean? With truth, with justice. Truth. وربنا الرحمن المستعان على ما تصفون وربنا and our Lord وربنا and our Lord الرحمن the most merciful that word الرحمن is not actually the خبر you may think وربنا our Lord is the most merciful It's our Lord, the most merciful, is Al-Musta'an. The Ar-Rahman is like Sifa for Rabbuna. Wa Rabbuna Ar-Rahman. Our Lord, the most merciful, is Al-Musta'an. What's Musta'an? You know the word? Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka? Nasta'in, ista'ala, yasta'inu means to seek help. So the Musta'in will be what? استعان يستعين استعانة فهو مستعين that's the one that seeks help and the one whose help is sought is المستعان so our Lord the most merciful is المستعان is the one whose help is sought is the one whose help we desire and whose help we look for وربنا الرحمن المستعان على ما تصفون The على ما تصفون is connected to that word المستعان What is Allah's help sought against? What is Allah's help sought for? His help is sought against ما تصفون that which they وصف يصف to ascribe تصفون it actually refers to you and you can see there's an iltifat happening over there There's a change in address happening over there. First, the verse starts what? قَالَ He said, رَبِّي رَبِّي أَوْ My Lord أُحْكُم بِالْحَقِّ But in the second part of the verse is what? وَرَبُّنَا الرَّحْمَنِ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ So, The first part of the verse is the Rasulullah saying, Oh my Lord, pass judgment with truth. The second part is Rabbuna. It cannot be Rasulullah alone. So this is the pronouncement of the believing people. Wa Rabbuna, our Lord, what am I saying? Wa Rabbuna Rahman. And our Lord, the most merciful, is the one whose help is sought against what? Tasifun? What you are ascribing, will that be referring to? The disbelievers. So, I change it again to the current discourse. Believing people conveying message to the disbelieving people. And what is this ma tasifun? What would that be referring to? It's all of the pronouncements that went against that core message of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ilahukum ilahu wahid. What was their claims? There's Lat, Manat, Uzza, all of these idols. We just worship these things to get closer to Allah. All of those type of things that they made. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has partners. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has daughters. Those were the claims that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is refuting him. Yes. Yes. No, that we are seeking Allah's help. We are seeking the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against those claims of these. وربنا الرحمن المستعان على ما تصفون. Our Lord most merciful is the one whose help is sought against all of those claims that they make. So firstly, what claims? Those claims that go against the message, ilahukum ilahu wahid. And by extension, any claim against Rasulullah would also be encompassed by that, because the means of coming to know ilahukum ilahu wahid is through the truth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, so the time is actually up. But just in conclusion, question. Okay, the word rahmatan is in nasb, but it's actually in nasb there because of the illa, not because of hasr. So the illa and hasr is separate. Hasr is just a concept of restriction. The most common occurrence of that would be using the word illa. Using innama. So when I say innama ana bashar, that means I am only a man. But sometimes when you want to restrict something, you can say more emphatically by negating everything else, then you can use the construction وَمَا أَنَا إِلَّا بَشَرًا. For example, I'm nothing but a. So in terms of language, it conveys the same meaning, but perhaps a little bit more emphatically. It doesn't affect the I'rab in any way. The I'rab changes because of the illa. The I'rab changes with the illa. And if I'm going to go to illa now, that's a lesson. Illa is, because illa depends if there's a positive verb before it, if there's a negative verb before it, if the thing that's coming afterward is mentioned before, alluded to before, or not alluded to before. There's a lot to consider. So hasr just refers to restriction. There's two common ways of doing it, either using innama or using wama and illa. Implies the same thing, the one is slightly more emphatic. But in terms of the I'rab of the thing that comes after illa, simple thing, most of the time it's going to be nasb. And actually, you can always put it in nasb, it will work. But just there's a lot of categories and a lot of detail to that. So, time doesn't allow. What I wanted to do just before conclusion is of the class, I just wanted to look at the surah and just list the different parts of the surah, the thematic overview of the surah. So, if we see, the surah started off with by speaking about the heedlessness of human beings about the hour. I'm taking this from At-Tafsir al-Mawdu'i. Right? The heedlessness of people regarding the hour and their turning away from the Quran. The second one, warning the people using wahi as a feature that all messengers shared. Then thirdly, the second one, using revelation. Because what is the first one? Heedlessness about the hour and turning away from the Quran. Right? Then the second one was using revelation to warn people was a feature of all of the messengers. Okay, sounds like the Titanic story. Maybe we must do this next week. I think, yeah, let's take a pause here. I'm going to go through it next week before we start the next surah. Tell me quickly, in terms of the order of the surah that we're doing, so what comes after Surah Anbiya? Surah Al-Hajj. Are you doing Surah Hajj already? Okay, the next one? Surah? Surah Mu'minun. Have you done that already? You're not doing it. Okay, then we'll do that one, inshallah. So we're going to start with that next week. I'm first just going to go through a thematic breakdown of the surah, the different sections, and perhaps we can see if we can see some structure in there, whatever. And then we'll move on to the next surah. بإذن الله تعالى وإن دفنا وجزاكم الله خيرا وآخر الدعوان الحمد لله رب العالمين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.